Good morning and welcome to our service as we clock off another month. We're now into August and hopefully you are feeling well. I hope enjoying the summer and able to worship with us this morning in peace and tranquility and a sense of trust. So we're going to come into the presence of the Lord together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins together as we pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. So we celebrate the good news of Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection, and our elevation to sons of the Most High. We say the Gloria together as a song of praise. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Almighty God, who sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church, open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now we'll have our two readings. We will listen to another hymn, and then we will share God's word together in the sermon.
A reading from the book of Ephesians. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel according to John. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
This morning I want to look at Paul's words in Ephesians 4, where, as in many other places in his writing, he speaks on the subject of unity. And, as elsewhere, in several other places, he speaks of unity using the image of a body with many parts. That's his preferred metaphor for the subject or concept of unity. Now, I wonder what you think unity means, especially applied to the church. Now, that might either mean a specific church like ours, how would we be united in what we do, or perhaps more interestingly to the church in general. What does unity actually look like? What does the word even mean? Well, unity is a state of oneness and harmony. It's a positive picture. You don't use unity in a negative way. It's not a pejorative word. And it's always thought of as something worth striving for, worth having, and worth protecting. And so losing it, becoming disunited or divided, is usually costly and negative. A disunited political party seldom succeeds. We've seen that in our own country. And nor will a divided body of the church, is what I want to suggest to you. I'm going to approach it in a particular way, and you may not agree, we may not be united on this, but see what you think. I'm really inviting you to think about the subject rather than necessarily agree or disagree with me. So my starting point is this, that we are united, whether we like it or not. All believers in Christ are united in Christ. We are in a relationship that unites us with him and every other believer. And that Paul calls the body of Christ. But we do not always behave as if that were true. So Jesus, for example, prays for his disciples that all would believe in him for all the ages, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you in me and I am in you. He prays that in that famous prayer in John 17:21. Scripture clearly says that believers are united with Christ because of our relationship with him, and therefore with all other believers. We're in the same family, even if we don't like it. Therefore, unity, this is my suggestion, has two aspects. One is the objective fact that we are one. And the other is the subjective experience and behaviour. Do we actually realise it? An objective and subjective unity can be true for any kind of group, a team, or even a family. All the members of a football team are objectively united because they belong to the same football team and they have the same goal. And they do not win or lose games individually. But individual brilliance may start to take over and to dominate. Rivalry may creep in. And when it does, it's more or less impossible for the team to behave in a united way. They are a unity, objectively, but the behaviour of individuals in the team may not match that, and usually that will lead to failure. Objective unity says we are united whether we like it or not. It's not up to us. But if we behave in a disunited way, as would be true in any body or team, we will not only hurt others, but we'll hurt ourselves. So as I've said, Paul in several places uses the analogy of a human body, many different parts, each performing very different and complementary tasks, but united as in one body. So in Ephesians 5:30, in addition to what we've read today, it says, we are members of his body. Ephesians 5:30. Paul uses the analogy again in 1 Corinthians 12, 12-21. Just as a body, though one has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. And he goes on in that passage to say this, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being a part of the body. And that's the interesting thing, isn't it? We are part of the body, whether we like the rest of the body or not, whether we agree with the rest of the body or not. And God has placed those parts in that body, every one of them, as he wanted them to be. The body cannot be just one part. It is many complementary different things. And if a body loses one of those parts, it suffers. If any one part of it rebels or starts to act against the rest of the body, well, that's where we see many of our most serious diseases, if I follow the analogy to its logical conclusion. And a lost part is not replaced by another part. It is lost forever, and it will be missed. If I lose one of my ears, then one of my feet cannot take over. That ear is lost, and the body is poorer for that. It may be compensated for it in the way that it adapts, but that part is never replaced. It is gone. It's sometimes said that no one is indispensable, but in the kingdom of God, that's probably not true. You are, as part of the body, indispensable, and so is the person next to you. The body cannot tolerate losing you because you are irreplaceable. Unity is sometimes easier to describe in terms of what it is not, and see if you agree with me here. Unity is not uniformity. We're all gloriously different and do different things, and that's the strength of a body. Nor is unity unanimity, by which I mean we're not united just because we agree on everything, because we clearly do not agree on everything. The glory of the unity of the body of Christ should be that it transcends disagreement and can tolerate it, even embrace it and see if it can redeem it and come to a better view. But the body of Christ has never been unanimous on every subject, but that doesn't mean to say it can't be united. Paul says we see as through a glass darkly. The kingdom of heaven does not lend itself to the certainties of the analysis of this world. There must always be room for different views and even mystery, and perhaps even saying, you know what? I don't know the answer to that question. That's not unanimity, but it can be unity if we are tolerant and loving towards other views. A phrase I came across which I quite like is this: unity is diversity under self-control. Unity is diversity under control. In other words, under the control of the person whose job it is to decide what they believe. The body is beautiful in its diversity, but if it's all its elements are under self-control and not asserting themselves over and above all the other elements, then it can be united. Jesus said, well, that is the model of how behaviour in the kingdom works, to not assert your view, not to over-assert your importance, but to offer yourself as a gift to others and make your diversity something of beauty, not of disunity. Jesus said, I am here not to be served, but to show you what God is like by serving. So I have no right to expect the body of Christ to serve me. I need to find ways of serving it. I don't expect it to affirm me or uphold my opinions, though I might like it to listen to them from time to time. I'm entitled to hold them and to offer them as a gift. But I can't insist on anything. I am subservient into the body. I'd like myself to be respected, but that's not why I'm here. I'd like myself to be respected, but that's not why I'm here. Why I'm here is to serve the body and to serve the head of the body, who is Christ. So we do not become disunited by being different or even by disagreeing. We break unity when we allow that to matter. We come broken when we allow our opinions to be subjectively superior to the objective truth of unity in Christ, when we get a bit too full of ourselves, actually. We become disunited when we start to think too highly of our own perspective, when our worldview and outlook becomes a dogma and is allowed to trump what Jesus portrayed for us in his life. See, disunity is as much a choice as unity is. Unity in Christ means that all believers are on relationship with him, and by extension to every other believer. We are united whether we like it or not. What we tend to think is that unity requires constant agreement on everything or forced compliance on everything. The problem is, there's no way to actually achieve that. There's no way to make people believe things they don't believe. Human beings are not made that way. So such a unity would be false. It would be forced and artificial, and possibly no better than disunity. What we need to learn is something which you might call subordination. Subordination is the basis for unity. Unity is not available on the basis of persuading everyone to agree with you. If Harrow Baptist Church and St Mary's and St John's and Trinity Methodist United Reformed Church and the Church of Our Lady and St Thomas, that's churches together in Central Harrow, if we do not agree on every aspect of faith and teaching, then actually I found it makes very little difference on what we do together. The opportunity is still there to act out our faith in Harrow, to feed the hungry, to alleviate unhappiness and serve Christ. That's not gone away. The truths that unite us transcend and supersede everything else. It's quite possible that Andrew and I in Harrow Baptist Church have a different view of baptism, for example. That's why he's a Baptist. It's quite possible that Father Derek Maguire at Our Lady has a different view on the Eucharist to me. That's why he's a Catholic and I'm an Anglican. But we are united because we believe in Christ. It's my opinion that we are united in the one truth that says Christ has come, Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. And that it is better to be united with all sorts of error going on than any attempt at doctrinal purity or unanimity. And I know that not everyone will agree with that. But again, the reason we become disunited is that we think too highly of our own position. It's a serious problem. So I'll finish with this in yet another passage from Paul, this time in Romans 12, verses 2 to 5. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, here's the body picture again, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each one of us. I don't think we have disunity in St. John's. I've never found it to be a divided or fragmented place. But the body of Christ globally is rather different. Will you pray for the unity of the body of Christ? Pray for your own role in the unity of the body of Christ, and prayerfully seek your place within it, because you are unique. You actually are indispensable. We cannot replace you, because you were put here by God. Amen, and God bless. So as we come as one people, we unite with the earthly church, the global church of God, as we say together the creed. and we proclaim, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now let's sit, kneel, or bow our heads as we're led in prayer.
In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gifts your Son Jesus Christ has given us. Grant that we may show forth these gifts and the fruits of the Spirit in how we live and work. We pray for Christians throughout the world and their leaders, that they may build up the body of the Church in love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the nations of the world, especially those facing war, famine, or natural disaster. Give wisdom and honesty to the leaders, and build up those working for peace and for better stewardship of the earth's resources. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our community and for all those working for the eradication of the pandemic and for a safe reopening of services. We give thanks for the other churches of Central Harrow and pray for their work. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are sick or suffering, anxious or lonely, including those who have been affected by the pandemic and all those who care for them. Let them all know your healing presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for those who have gone before us, especially those who have influenced our lives for good. We pray for those who mourn. Grant that we may in good time join you in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We come now to the sacraments as we share the bread and wine together, so please make preparations to participate at the appropriate moment. But first we share the peace with one another. Peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father. Peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Peace from the Holy Spirit, the life-giver. The peace of the triune God be always with you. Amen. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Gather as we share the sacrament of the body and blood of Christ. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. By your Holy Spirit, you make us your friends. And so we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, and as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. So we pray together. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. The blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. Holy Father, who gathered us here around the table of your Son to share this meal with the whole household of God, in that new world where you reveal the fullness of your peace, gather people of every race and language to share in the eternal banquet of Jesus Christ our Lord. And we pray together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for spending the time to worship with us, whether you're on YouTube or with us in the Zoom call. It's our privilege to share worship with you. You should have received this week a written messenger and a separate prayer calendar for the month to come. Originally we weren't going to do one in August, but I changed my mind just to reinforce the messages that we've been putting out over the past few weeks. We have made some small changes in church for those who are coming to worship in person. We have not yet reintroduced singing, sung worship, or the sung Eucharist, and we are still serving communion in one kind at the moment. That is under periodic review. By the time we get to September, then we are planning to go back to one service, and that is scheduled to be September the 19th. The unknowns at the moment are whether the current sustained fall in case rates and infection rates is maintained. On the day of recording, the news was good. Things are on a good roll. We have not yet seen the impact of Freedom Day, so-called. So we're waiting to see that. And we will make those decisions in the first half of August for the remainder of the time through to the middle of September. But we're hoping and praying and confident that by mid-September, we will be worshipping normally, or as near normally as we can, again, both singing and serving in both kinds, if that is appropriate for the time. So that's it for now. I will keep you updated on email, on the website, face-to-face and in church, and by post for some of you, as well as we go through the month of August. Just to announce also that the second half of August I will be on holiday. So from August the 13th onwards until the end of that month, Jill and I will be away. So Ajay and David and others will be here to maintain the services and attend to your needs, as it were. But that's just to let you know in advance. So let us receive God's blessing, and then we can go and enjoy our day. The Lord be with you. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.